Here we go again. I'm here with Melissa Benua. She's an engineering manager at mParticle. Mm-hmm. And we are going to talk a little bit about containers.
Yes.
And the role that containers play in contesting and whatnot. And really, everyone's just talking about containers right now.
Yeah, containers are it, right? They are sort of a revolutionary and evolutionary step in what we can do when we're talking about changes that need testing. And mm-hmm. test environments.
Right, and I think in your tutorial, you gave two tutorials mm-hmm. already this week. In one of them, you talk about, you know, everyone wants containers, but why do you need containers, and how is your team going to benefit from the use of those containers?
Right, exactly. So I walk through a couple of specific scenarios about here's, you know, how the problems with test environments, and here's how we've traditionally used a test environment to test our code. And usually it's not one, it's 20 that you're trying to share. And here's how not just you can duplicate that test environment in a containerized test environment and get at least as good functionality, but here's the additional cool things you can do when you have, you know, a container repository, and you can just pull down the same copy of code that's in production, including the OS image and the SDK versions and your package versions, and just grab them and use them, whether microservice style or monolith or whatever, and use them against, whatever change you're investigating or testing.
Right. So for someone that's new in this idea of containers and containerized testing, what do you think the first step in kind of getting into understanding the impact they can have and the importance they have is? The first step in getting started, I guess.
So the first step in getting started is there's some pretty good documentation both on the Docker site or on a few other places about how do I make a container. And the first thing to do is just make a really simple container. If you're, you know, whatever language you're in, make a very simple Linux container that hosts your code. Stand it up, run it. Understand, you know, the basics of what does a Docker file look like. And then, you know, see how it is on your machine, and then maybe make two services. Stitch them together using Docker Compose. Docker Compose is very simple. And then you have two services. Explore how they run together, what the virtual network looks like, how they talk to each other. And once you've got two services, all of a sudden you start to realize, oh, well, I could test these this way. I could do an end-to-end test, and it look, you know, would be simpler, would look different. I have control over my data. I have control over my code. You have all these possibilities start appearing as soon as you start playing with it.
Right, yeah, and I think that's really kind of true of a lot of things that we do in software and testing is, you know, experiment with it and give it a shot because you don't know really what's possible until you do give something a shot.
Exactly. I mean, it's a tool like any other. It can be learned like any other tool. You don't have to be a DevOps master to understand how to stand up a container and how to run a container. It's no different than learning to use a compiler or a new IDE. Can be pretty simple.
Right, and you mentioned DevOps, and obviously we're at a testing conference, but mm-hmm. DevOps is still the buzz right now in software.
Yes.
And, you know, people are wanting to move to continuous testing and continuous delivery and, mm-hmm. and whatnot. What role, you know, do maybe what we would consider traditional testers play in that DevOps journey?
So it sort of depends on your organization. I've mm-hmm. seen traditional testers become what is considered DevOps because they own, test infrastructure gets lumped into there. I've seen, so in my company, for example, test sort of ends where DevOps begins. I own the parts of the CI pipeline up to where packages are created. You know, how do we do Docker locally? And then the DevOps team owns how do we, you know, take those packages and deploy them out, you know, broadly, make them scale, manage them, you know, at scale and production.
Right. So, yeah, that's really awesome. And something else I know you're passionate about is the design of tests as well.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, how they're written and how they're designed and how we're automating them into our continuous delivery and continuous testing pipelines. You know, what is it, I guess, that makes a good test design and how do people go about kind of creating those tests in a way that are going to be beneficial when they get into some continuous environment?
Yeah, so, I mean, good test is a good test, but when you're running continuously, there's a few extra requirements that a good test has to have. They have to be very reliable. My number one thing that I always spend time discussing passionately with people when they're in my tutorial is if you have a flaky test, it's doing you more harm than good and you should delete it. Period, end of story. It's better to have no test than a flaky test. You can't have slow tests. You know, in a continuous system, those tests may run hundreds and hundreds of times a day. They can't, you know, you can't wait 5 or 6 minutes per test case. They have to be as fast as possible. Or if you're gonna wait 5 minutes, it better have a very, very good ROI. Developers are impatient. I'm impatient. You know, they're not gonna wait. You know, I've learned the common understanding that I've seen over again and over again in my teams is developer will wait at most 5 minutes for unit test and build. That's it.
Wow.
And more than that, they start complaining, they start bypassing your build, they look for ways around the system. And that's, you know, if that's what's happening, you know you've got a problem.
Right, yeah, and I love that you mentioned that speed's important, but what you led with is the quality of the test.
Yes.
And while speed is important, to your point, if we have flaky tests running fast, does that really help us? Probably not. So that quality portion of it, I think that's so important to make sure that you're delivering high-quality tests.
So important. We always have discussions. Somebody was asking me, but what about if we might fix that bug later? If we don't have the failing, you know, the failing test, how do we know that we should fix the bug later? Which my point was always, the bug is never more important than the minute you find it. If it's not important enough to fix the minute you find it, then it's definitely not important enough to remind you about for the next 8 months while you continue to not find it important enough to fix.
Right.
It's the only thing you're doing with failing tests or undeterminate tests is training people to ignore your tests. I know that I've been on plenty of teams that have not been rigorous about, it's just that test again, it's just that test again. And then in ignoring, it was just that test again, missed the one extra failure that slid in, and oops, that was a live-side incident.
Right, yeah, and we talked about today, one of the sessions I was in, they said, yeah, the test runs and it failed, and the developer just says, that's meant to happen. Well, is it meant to happen, or should we fix either the code or the test to make sure that what's meant to happen is being tested to happen what's supposed to happen?
Yeah.
Or what the user is expecting to happen. You know, the developer can write the code, but if they don't use the product, if they don't use the service, then they might not know what the user wants to happen.
So actually it's a really interesting point you brought up. So one of the other things I cover in my test design is the concept of a bug of implementation, which is the developer just wrote bad code, versus a bug of understanding, which is the developer didn't understand the user scenario correctly or didn't correctly interpret the requirements. And you want to be, bugs of implementation are usually functional tests. They're very easy to understand that I did a +++ instead of a -, and it's just wrong. Mm-hmm. The bugs of understanding are much harder to automate and harder to find, especially for a developer to find. You know, a developer can't find all of the places where they misunderstood the requirements from somewhere else. It's like asking you to proofread your own essay.
Right.
You can't do it.
Right. Yeah, and Jeff Payne, I think, touched on his keynote this morning about, you know, that we still have manual testing in all of our situations because the users are always going to be manual, right? They're always going to be some person at the end of the day is using the product.
Exactly.
And we're going to have to, even if we have an automated pipeline, we're going to have to go back and make changes and fix bugs based on what the user experience and what the user expects.
Yeah, and so that's the secret is, of course, we have extensive automation, and of course we have huge, you know, regression suites, even functional versus non-functional. But any company who's doing all of that investment is still going to have some manual testing, even if they may not call it manual testing. We call it scenario validation. So when a developer delivers a scenario to a product owner, the product owner takes responsibility to validate that delivered thing meets what they wanted, what their customer needed. Even if it's, you know, they just click through real quick, walk the scenario from the customer's point of view and sign off, that's still testing. They're not software testers in that if I said, are you a tester, they would say no, but they're testing.
Right.
They're testing and they're validating and they're becoming the advocate for the user.
I love that. I love that scenario validation. I'm going to use it. I really love that because that really is what it is. I was talking to someone that was doing some AI testing, and they were testing the Target app. And you know, to register and log in for an account on the Target app is 11 different steps you have to take to get onto a Target app.
Yikes. That's, to go buy things, to buy toothpaste.
Right, and the thing
it's faster
is
to just walk in and buy the toothpaste.
Exactly, and the automation works. The testers have said, yes, this is what we expected to happen, but they needed someone to validate the scenario and say, is this what we want?
Functionally correct,
yes.
But not correct according to the user's point of view.
Right, so how important, I guess that last step, I mean, the automation is great. We can get great tests out, we can get them out faster, we can continuously check them, but at the end of the day, it's the user. I mean, users who we're developing products for.
Yeah, and so the interesting part of being containerized and having containerized environments as a part of your continuous delivery system is that there's room for both validations to happen before a change lands into mainline or lands into whatever your continuous integration system is. At the time the developer has a piece of code, has a change up for review, of course we run our full functional suite, we run our regression suite, maybe we do some UI regression automation, whatever. Of course we run all the automation. But at the same time, you take that change, you deploy it to a containerized environment that you can start ad hoc, and you give it to whoever your scenario owner is, and you say, hey, can you please go validate the scenario? Here's my change, here it is, sitting on a machine that's in an environment that's nearly the same as production because it's containerized to look just like production, and they can actually validate their scenario makes sense end to end as well. And so when you're landing that change in, it's been tested not just to be functionally correct, but correct according to the requirements.
Right.
Before, so no need for, you know, a shared dev environment whatsoever.
Right. Once you get, obviously the containers are built, this is for my edification. Once the containers are there, right, you mentioned they are set up to be the same as production, but those, could they ever be identically the same?
They sure can.
Okay.
So a container, right, a container is just layers of images. So the base image, you know, is your OS, you know, Linux version, whatever, whatever, with a kernel, whatever. And that can should absolutely be the same as it is in production. You should only ever have one of those. And then the next layer may be, what's my runtime environment? I work in .NET a lot, so say, okay, we're always installing .NET Core 2.2.100 version 9. So that's always the same in production, test, whatever you're doing, build machines too. And then again, you layer your dependencies, and your dependencies are your dependencies. You set your package dependencies in the same base image. And so the only thing that differs may be configuration. It could be, you know, you want to use test keys instead of production keys because you don't want to be leaking your production keys anywhere.
Right.
So you may have slight configuration differences from that point of view. And then you have just the very specific, you know, the commit SHA, the actual change under review may be slightly different. You know, production will have the signed off on code from your master branch, and your, you know, ad hoc environment will have whatever codes in your PR.
Right, yeah, I think it's just such a great, the containers are such a great way to get people to be able to see it in the production environment or basically the same exact environment before it gets out into production.
There's no hardware differences, there's no OS version differences, there's no, oh, this is four patches behind, this one has this bug fix in the SDK. It's not a problem anymore.
Right, and that after that gets delivered, are we still testing in production then?
You can.
Right.
I mean, so as long as you don't have merge problems, you're unlikely to introduce a regression.
Right.
Most of, you know, if we're going to have a problem where we're going to catch something in production that we didn't get caught earlier is because a bad merge happened. The more automated your merges can be and the more frequently you're merging and coming back and not doing weird merge strategies, the less likely that is to happen. And then you really don't need to test in production. I mean, you can if it makes you feel better, but you should have your monitoring in place such that you know if something catastrophic happened, you know if there's a problem, if you've got a user dip, an error spike, whatever, that should be enough.
Okay, yeah, that all definitely makes a lot of sense, and I think that you know, containers are really there, and I think that people are starting to learn more ways that they can use them to create systems where, once it gets to production, things are obviously running smoothly, and we're not kind of falling behind and having a lot of issues in production, which of course are going, you know, we probably don't have any products out there that are perfect, that are going to be flaw-free.
Right, nothing is perfect. Nothing is, nothing is bug-free, and if somebody tells you they're selling you a bug-free product, I would ask what bug-free means to them, because there's an asterisk in there somewhere.
Yeah, absolutely. Melissa, thank you for your time. I always love talking to you.
Yeah, thanks. It's fun, Owen.
Yeah, thank you.